Community Association. We've kind of put this together pretty quick. I'm very pleased to see this turnout. I want to thank Thornhill for the use of their facility and all the nice decorations that they have, and especially Judy LeFay back there, who did all the stuff that wasn't the Christmas decorations. So we're here tonight for, as everybody should know, candidate forum for State House District 50, which was suddenly vacated recently. And we're here to learn more about the five candidates. And rather than go through introductions, I'll let them introduce themselves. Well, I'll let Cleve Gaddis is going to be our moderator today. And we can go through the introductions and how we're going to work this.
So good evening, everyone. I was getting my instructions as to what I'm supposed to do when I moderate, and Judy said I could walk back and forth behind the clients and make faces. So I'm not sure this is going to be a very professional.
That's exactly what you said.
No, you don't want me to tell everybody that? Okay. I too am impressed, by the way, that we have such a good crowd with only 1 week's notice. And just as a reminder, this is a special election that will be held on Tuesday, January 6th to fill the vacancy for House District 50. Early voting begins on Monday, December the 15th, and runs through January the 2nd, 9 a.m. to 6 p.m. at the Johns Creek Environmental Campus, which is located at 8100 Holcomb Bridge Road, which is right where Holcomb Bridge crosses the river, if you're interested. The forum is supposed to last 4.5 hours. We're supposed to go on for about 90 minutes. We'll probably have time to go through 13 or 14 rounds of questions, depending upon the answers. Each candidate will have 2 minutes for their opening statement. All candidates will answer the same question in round robin format. Unfortunately, because of her last name starts with an A, Christine, you will start with the opening statements, and then we would just go right down the line with each candidate starting first and coming back to the last one that has not answered. Answers will be limited to 1 minute unless otherwise instructed by me, and I would only do that just if we need to get some more information that would be helpful to the attendees. I can ask follow-up questions if it would also be beneficial for the attendees. We will ask pre-written questions that have been pre-submitted. You will also have the opportunity to submit additional questions. I will tell you in advance that we'll probably only have time to work in about 4 or 5 of these questions. If your question does not get asked, please don't be offended. We're trying to make sure that we cover as many subjects as we possibly can, but if you'd like to fill out a card and just hand it in here to Judy LeFay, we will try to get that worked into the agenda. Candidates had the opportunity to submit their questions in advance. They may or may not be included. There's no guarantees that any questions that are submitted will be asked or asked as written. And any candidate that is referred to by another candidate in that candidate's answer will have the opportunity to provide clarification or for rebuttal. And each candidate will have 2 minutes for a closing statement and 2 minutes for an opening statement. And just in an effort for full disclosure, I want to disclose that my firm had a business relationship with Christine Austin sometime in the last 3 or 4 years. That will not in any way affect the forum tonight or my handling it as a moderator, but I wanted to make sure that everybody understood. So without further ado, Christine, we will open it up to you and we will let you give your opening statement.
Okay. Well, hello. I'm Christine Austin. I'll just tell you a little bit about myself. I am a mother, 6-year-old boy. I'm on the board of the PTA, and I'm also on the board of the HOA. I've been legislative director and community liaison, so I've been as involved as I can be. I work mostly from home. So I've decided to enter this election because I wanted to give the people of Johns Creek a choice. I think that we don't often have real choices. because we have Democrats and Republicans who tend to be very similar in their views. You'll find throughout this discussion that I am a little different from both of them. As a Libertarian, my views are going to be somewhat different, and you'll find that I am not a politician. I don't want to be a politician. I want to be a representative. I want to go to the Capitol and represent your best interests. I have no interest in a career. I just want to go do what's best for the state of Georgia. And what I think is best for the state of Georgia is a lot more freedoms tempered with responsibility. So this is a difficult decision to enter a race at this time of year. And I thought about it for a long time. But what really pushed me over was a discussion with my son. He's 6 years old, and I said, what do you think? And he said, you should do it. And I said, why? And he said, because it's important. He said, making laws is important. And he's right. How can I argue with that? Making laws is important, and I can't just leave it up to anybody, so I felt like it was time for me to step out into the light. I've always worked behind the scenes for years and years. I've worked behind the scenes, and now it's time to do something about it. So hopefully you'll like what you hear.
Thank you. Brad?
Good evening. My name is Brad Raffensperger. I am a committed conservative. I think I'm probably the most conservative person up in this race. I guess we'll debate that tonight. But I do have a positive vision for House District 50. I believe in economic development, and I believe that we can have more economic development and innovation by eliminating the state income tax and moving towards the fair tax.
Speak up someplace.
We can't hear her back here.
Okay. I have my soft voice on tonight, I guess. Sorry about that. So I would like to eliminate the state income tax, and I'd like to move to the fair tax, because I think that will promote economic development, innovation, and I think it helps the average taxpayer also. So it's a win-win-win all the way around. I think what we saw last year with Fulton County jacking up our taxes, our property taxes went up 17%. You added in 3.59% tax digest, there was another increase there, it's over 20%. I think it's time that we really need to work hard and rigorously towards creating Milton County. I also believe that if we have Milton County, taxes will go down and service levels will go up. We're paying more, but we're not getting better services. And I think it's time that we have control over our financial destiny. So I will support property tax relief. I'll put out a flyer on that, because I believe that if we increase the homestead exemptions from $30,000 to $60,000, it's going to be property tax relief for homeowners. I've never increased taxes. In fact, last January, I proposed to reduce your millage rate by 1 mil. I wrote it, I sponsored it, it was co-sponsored by Adam Figueroa. Some of the people on the dais did not support it and voted against that tax cut. I voted for a tax cut. I never voted for a tax increase. I'm a fiscal conservative. I am supported by Georgia Right to Life. I'm a member of NRA. I filled out their application. I think they're gonna like what they see. That's what I am. It's your, I guess, conservative Republican that believes in fiscal responsibility.
Thank you. Royce?
Thank you. Thanks to everybody for coming tonight. Hopefully I'll speak loud enough for everybody to hear me. By education and life experience, I'm a mathematician, physicist, mechanical engineer, civil engineer, salesman, recruiter, project manager of multi-billion dollar projects, and business owner. I have lived in Minnesota, Puerto Rico, Michigan, Connecticut, Massachusetts, Florida, California, Iowa, Arkansas, Texas, Louisiana, Illinois, Wisconsin, and Washington, D.C. I relocated to the Northeast Fulton County from San Francisco in 1979 to grow an engineering office from 4 to over 450 employees, and to be part of the growth of this area from pastures and forests to what it is today. I have been a resident of House District 50 since 1986. By the year 2000, I was able to accumulate a sufficient fortune to be able to retire and spend more time with my family and on community activities. I've been part of a team for 38 years, and many of you know my wife, Nancy. By nature, I am given to fully understanding the facts of an issue and to using reasoning and teamwork to achieve the best solution possible given multiple factors. I'm running to give you a choice of someone who will reach out to you to explain the issues, seek your input, and govern based on facts, reasoning, and understanding. To put it another way, I believe that you deserve better than politics based on misrepresentation, manipulation, self-interest, secrecy, and laziness. I'm looking forward to answering your questions tonight.
Thank you. Kelly?
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I want to first thank the JCCA for hosting tonight's event. And for those of you who do not know me, my name is Kelly Stewart. I want to tell you a little bit about myself. I am running for this office because I believe that we need a leader who has three things: someone who is experienced, and someone who is who has great principles, and someone who has great leadership. With my experience, I was in my second term on the Johns Creek City Council, and I served as Mayor Pro Tem. I have also worked in all three levels of the government. At the federal level of government, I worked in Washington, D.C. in the U.S. House of Representatives for then Congressman Nathan Deal. At the state level, I worked in the University System of Georgia. And at the local level, I worked as a county administrator. I have been appointed to two statewide boards. Governor Deal appointed me to serve on the board of directors for the Department of Juvenile Justice. And in that capacity, I also serve as a school board member. I was also appointed to serve on the board of directors for the Georgia Municipal Association, which is an umbrella for all the cities in Georgia in which they can do their work. I am a businesswoman that has worked very hard, and I rose to the top of my career by working for a national company. I'm a vice president of human resources, and we have employees throughout the states in 22 states. I have a master's degree from Georgia Tech in city planning, a bachelor's degree from Brunel in public administration, and an associate's degree from Gainesville State in psychology. With the principles that I have, I am a straight shooting person. I don't play petty politics. I was the lone sole council member last year who stood against all the nasty politics that cost our city money, that divided the city, and that brought great humiliation to us. That is the kind of person that we need to lead us as a state representative in the state capitol, and I look forward to earning your vote.
Thank you. Paul?
So nice to see you. It's going to be a nice group tonight. If I haven't met you before, please, afterwards, please come over and just say hello, just so I can thank you for being here. I'd like to do that. I'm running again. I ran in the general election. I'm running now as an independent. If you attended the forum that we had in October, something interesting happened, at least it affected me. We had two Republican candidates with very safe seats. They got cocky. They did something stupid. They told the truth. And what they said was, the plan is, as state revenues increase, as we eventually get back, as we go to recovery, their plan is to put drips and drabs of money back into different programs, but their primary goal was to reduce the state income tax from 6% to 5%. They weren't talking about bringing schools back to the full funding level that we had before. We're still operating without a full curriculum. And I'm thinking to myself, a tax cut on the backs of children? No. I got angry, and I'm still angry. We need full return to at least the budget levels we had before. We're not asking for increasing the overall education budget, but give us back what we had before so we can have a full curriculum and a full school experience. And that's why I'm running.
Thank you. Thank you. I forgot to mention that we do have a time card process. Dave Kornbluh is sitting in the front row. We've been asked by the candidates not to hold up 30-second, 15-second warnings. It is a little bit distracting to the candidate. So unfortunately, as soon as he holds up the card, I'm just going to say time. And I know that's probably not the easiest way, but if that's what you guys prefer, that's what we will do. And if you don't stop talking, then I will say time even louder. So you can stop talking. And then certainly feel free to stand. In fact, based on what I think is increased volume to the back, I would encourage you to stand up when you possibly can, because I think it's a lot easier to hear when they stand up. Am I right in the back? So please stand up if you can. We will start with the first round of questions. We will start with Brad. We will go to Paul and then and finish with Christine. And the first question is, recent reports indicate Georgia will need at least $1 billion to maintain its roads in the near future and probably another billion on top of that just for minimal improvements. What are your thoughts on solutions to our traffic problems, and how do you propose we pay for these solutions?
Well, if you ask me what our biggest issue in Johns Creek.
Stand up.
If you don't
you
mind.
Have to.
I think it's so much easier for everybody.
Sure. I'm Brad, by the way. In case you couldn't hear me last time. If you look at what our biggest issues in Johns Creek are, apart from the Milton County, Fulton County issue, it is transportation. And then really statewide, that's an issue. One of the things that's been pointed out recently is that 1% of the 4% of gas tax dollars has been was redirected years ago and taken from transportation road construction into the general fund. If you repatriated that back into the transportation fund, that'd be $185 million a year. Now, that doesn't sound like a lot, except when you consider that at the local level, what you'll see is that we get grants all the time and we get funding from other sources. At the state level, typically, there's a funding formula that's really, if you put in 10%, you get 90% federal funds. So right there, you can have a factor of 10 times. Doesn't sound like much for one year, but over 10, it adds up.
Thank you. Royce?
Okay. I'm sort of a facts-driven person, so let me start by giving you a little bit of background. The state of Georgia only spends 4% of its revenues on transportation, and out of its total spending, only 5% is on transportation. So it is not a focus for the state, first of all, which leads me to the question of why we've had two council members resign city council, where they could have addressed transportation issues to go run for the state house, where transportation is not the biggest issue. The biggest issue for the state of Georgia and its spending is education and health care. And ahead of transportation comes corrections and debt service, if you can believe that. Transportation is a big problem. The place to address transportation is in city government. I think Mike Bodker has been doing an excellent job of that. And at the regional level, such as Atlanta Regional Commission, through all the cities coming together and addressing the transportation. The state is focused on the Port of Savannah. Transportation, in the state's terms, is the Port of Savannah because of its impact on the entire state.
Time.
And it's not the focus of the State House or Johns Creek.
And Dave, I hate to change the rules, but do you have a 15-second card?
I do.
It's just not fair to the candidates, just out of the blue time. If you'll just hold up a 15-second card, I'm sorry if it bothers you, but we need to give you a chance to be able to wind down. Now, Mike, do you want to rebut any of the comments? Do you want to rebut that?
That was a compliment.
I just wanted to give you the opportunity to come in. Kelly, and by the way, if you need the question, me to reread the question, I'll be happy to. It was a long one.
But, oh, I'm good. Kelly, thank you. There are two meaningful ways that we can address transportation in the state of Georgia. The first is to take that fourth penny of that sales tax on motor fuel sales and devote it to the transportation programs. Right now, as you heard a minute ago, it goes into the general fund for non-transportation programs, and that must stop. We seriously need to change that. The second way is to prioritize our spending on reducing gridlock that affects Johns Creek and affects the region, and oppose the waste of transportation dollars that are making roads that go to nowhere throughout the state.
Thank you. Paul.
I do think transportation is a major state issue. If you study Georgia's economy, we're the transportation state. Our entire economy is built on the fact that we're the crossroads of the South, and this is good. This is very good. One of the most interesting things was back in 12 years ago when Sonny Perdue became governor, the first thing he did was to cancel the outer perimeter highway, the Northern Arc, that would have connected I-75, I-85, crossing 400 into this area. It would have been a tremendous benefit of bypassing 285 and having the truck traffic off of 285 moving it further north. and it was canceled. It was a bad decision then, it's a bad decision today. We've got to revive the Northern Arc. And this is the first priority in transportation that I will have in the State House.
Thank you. Christine?
Okay, I have a lot to say on this. I'll try to talk fast. First of all, I would not take federal money because federal money comes with strings attached. I would encourage the state of Georgia to, in a coalition with other states, to stop accepting federal money with strings attached and start keeping our money here. Because we, if they are taxing us and then offering to give our money back with strings, then that means they're overtaxing us. And that's an issue we need to deal with. As far as transportation, building more roads I don't think is the solution. I think we need to look at the problem, which is people don't live where they work. That's why we have so many cars on the road. And there's a lot of ideas to address that. One, I'll give you an example, is we could change some of the housing requirements. Georgia has laws that prohibit how people live and who can live together, so that young professionals are not able to band together in a boarding house situation that they could afford where they could live close to work. They're forced out into the suburbs where apartments are cheaper. There's a lot of examples of things like that where Georgia regulates how we live our lives and forces us to make decisions that are not necessarily in our best interest.
Time. Thank you. One of the questions later in the forum was going to be about the motor fuel revenue formula for the state of Georgia. Just to provide some clarification, what a couple of candidates have mentioned is that Georgia currently charges a 7.5 cents per gallon excise tax and a 4% sales tax per gallon, so it's on average 20 cents per gallon to the state of Georgia. And of the $1 billion that is collected using that formula, about $180 million does go into the general fund. I'm just clarifying that because I'm going to skip over that question. It'll give us more time for other questions later. So the next question, we will start with Royce. And the question is, how do you plan to improve K through 12 public education throughout Georgia? Additionally, do you support changes to state and local funding formulas? I don't know the exact numbers, but I believe generally over 50% of the funds for all of the public school districts come from the state, and I think there's a lot of issues with how that funding works. So just to provide some clarification, Royce.
This is the important issue in the state of Georgia. Georgia spent 54% of the budget in the state of Georgia is spent on education. What Georgia does at the state level is give money to school systems. And this is the quality basic education formula that we have. And what's the funding for the states? Georgia believes in local control. The state isn't there really to tell the state how the school systems to run. The schools, the local school boards do that. But the states play a vital role in funding our schools such that we have good schools throughout the state. It's important to me to look at the quality basic education formula to ensure adequate funding and to incentivize our 179 school systems to become more cost efficient. We have 179 school systems in Georgia. I believe they need to be encouraged to right size. We shouldn't have school systems that are too small to serve our students effectively or too big that they're disconnected from the public.
Thank you. Kelly?
Johns Creek is very fortunate to have such a great school system, but unfortunately we can't say that throughout the rest of the state. What is important for our state is that we have strong schools and a skilled workforce so that we can attract great businesses here to make sure that we have a good economic success for our state and for our nation. I support three things when it comes to education. I support innovation, I support greater accountability, and I support increased flexibility for the parents. I also think that school choice is something that we have to have. Parents have the right, the obligation, and the responsibility to make the best decision for their child, and we should not have a child ever trapped in a failing school. I also support charter schools, and I do not support Common Core at all. Common Core, I do believe in tough standards. I do not believe in national standards. I believe that the parents, the teacher, and the local administrator need to decide what's best for the child.
Thank you, and I apologize. I know that 15-second card is distracting, but I think it'll make it work better for everybody. Paul?
All right, let's talk realities here. If you were, again, going back to that candidate forum in October, the Republicans were very clear. They were dismissing the current quality basic education formula. They were going to bring that down. You just simply think they were going to do. The reality is the candidates here have all committed to following Governor Nathan Deal in reducing that formula. Even if they wanted to do something else, the truth of the matter is for them, it's a get along, go along, forget out type situation. Real world. Only you can make a statement that you want the funding back into education, that you want education's priority. If this district, one the Republicans consider in their back pocket, they don't have to really look at, if you make a statement, I assure you, it will send a thunderclap through the state capitol. You have that power. This is what this election should be about.
Thank you. Since all of the candidates were mentioned in that, I'd like to give you an opportunity to state whether or not you follow Nathan Deal in terms of education, as Paul indicated.
I don't follow anybody.
Okay. A general statement was made that everybody follows the governor, and I think everybody would like to hear whether or not they do.
I support our governor. And but I think the point of that question requires more than just a 10-second answer.
Okay. I think he was speaking specifically on policies regarding education.
That's very broad.
Okay.
I think it comes to an understanding of the job of a state legislature led by a governor. I think we've all voted for a Republican governor just this past election, and it's the members of the House are going to support the governor. The governor is increasing the budget for education by 6%, and I support him in that activity. Georgia revenues are going up 5%. He's putting the money in education. He is not putting it in transportation. He's only increasing transportation by 2%. He's increasing education by 6%, and I support him in that effort.
Thank you. Kelly?
Yes, I do support following the governor.
Okay. And I apologize, by the way, Brad, that was not meant to cause anybody any issues at the front. I apologize if that was taken that way. We do still have the opportunity for Christine and for you, Brad, to answer the question, how do you plan to improve K-12 public education throughout Georgia? Additionally, do you support changes in state and local funding formulas?
Well, first of all, there are about 2 million people, 2 million students in the state of Georgia. They're not all the same. They're all very different. They have very different needs, different aptitudes. The only people who should be making decisions about the education of these children are the children and their parents. So I support pushing all the decisions back at the local level, but even more than the local level, to the parents. I'm for school choice, not just for charter schools, but encouraging more privatization of schools so that parents really have the choice back in their own hands. Because these children are very different, and education is where they spend most of their time. They spend, 30% of their waking hours in schools. It's way too important of a decision to hand it over to the government. It's a personal, private, family decision. So privatization and more school choice is what I would support.
Thank you. Brett?
The education budget ranges from a 52 to 57% each year. And maybe perhaps education spending has been lower in the last few years, but the overall budget for the statewide was down 22% during the recession. You just heard from one of the speakers that this year revenues are back up 5%, and yet the governor's adding 6%. I think that at all levels of state government, from the Republican leadership, we support education. Two of my sisters are teachers. My wife has a degree in early childhood education. I appreciate education. I'm an engineer. But saying that, I still think the most important thing we can do is teach people how to read and how to write. If people can't communicate, it really holds them back. You take two engineers with the same technical ability, the one that can explain himself the best, you know, is the one that really will do the best. I support school choice. I support charters, vouchers, and other innovations like online learning. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question, we will begin with Kelly. Mm-hmm. What do you see as the real goal of tax reform? Should reform result in more or less revenue for the state of Georgia? Also, since fair tax is a hot topic for some, please include any thoughts you may have on fair tax.
Okay. Let me tell you my position on taxes. It's very easy. I have never supported a tax increase. I will never support a tax increase. I signed the American Tax Pledge Reform, and I will be true to that pledge. I am for comprehensive tax reform in the way of eliminating the state income tax and reducing and putting a cap on the property tax. And I want to introduce a very simple and fair tax for everyone. I am not for taxing productivity. I am for taxing consumption.
Thank you. Paul?
I've given you all a brief explanation of the fair tax. And you'll understand, it is a tax increase. For 80% of Americans, if you put pencil to pad and you work out the numbers, you will see it's a tax increase. The people who paid to have this plan designed intended to have their taxes reduced at your expense. Their taxes would go down, they'd make up the difference in revenue by increasing your taxes. It's a very, very simple thing. It's not hard to understand. It's been very well sold, very cleverly sold, but when you put pencil to paper, it's a very clear thing. It's a tax increase. So anyone who says they're for the fair tax, then it's not a tax increase. No, they're not telling you the truth, flat out. In fact, I quote Forbes magazine, even points out the exact same thing. It's a nightmare tax. It leaves, there are all sorts of loopholes written in it so that the wealthy will not pay any tax at all, and there are enough ways organized crime can use it. It's a boon for organized crime in doing this.
Thank
it's
you.
A terrible idea.
Thank you, Paul. Christine.
Well, we can't talk about taxes without acknowledging all of the taxes that we pay, because it's not just income taxes and property taxes and ad valorem taxes and fuel taxes, but we're also paying fines, permit fees, licensing fees, speeding tickets. All these are forms of taxation. But in addition, every time you purchase a product, you're paying for all the taxes that were paid as that product was produced. So there are a lot of embedded taxes that we don't even realize we're paying. All of that needs to be considered in any tax initiative. But I am also for eliminating property tax, because that is a rent that the state is charging you on property you already own. They can take your property away if you don't pay your taxes, and that doesn't need to, that property rights are too important for that. Corporate income tax needs to go first, because that's just passed on to the consumer and makes our companies less productive. I also support a consumption tax, because that is fair for everybody. If we pay, we're not paying taxes on our wealth or our earnings, we are paying taxes only on what we consume. It encourages savings. It also taxes visitors and tourists and undocumented aliens equally.
Thank you.
Can I repeat the question again?
Yes.
It was a long question.
Yes. What do you see as the real goal of tax reform? Should reform result in more or less revenue for the state? Also, since fair tax is a hot topic for some, please indicate any thoughts you may have on the fair tax.
Well, I support the fair tax. I've been clear about that. I think we need to work towards eliminating the state income tax. It works well in Texas, Tennessee, and Florida. South Carolina tried to put that on their ballot for ballot initiative to do away with it over 4 years. So eventually, when all the surrounding states have it, we're going to have to face it. So we can face it now or face it later. It'll actually flatten out and increase the that everyone pays into the system. I think it's a fair way to run the system. Whatever I do support, if it comes for a vote, I want to make sure that is revenue neutral. I do think that we need to have some protections for seniors, because with their income right now, it's a fixed income, and we need to make sure that they aren't hurt by it. But I think that is the way to go. As it relates to tax increases, I believe I've never voted for a tax increase, and I think that we can live within our means, and the state is doing well. I think we'll actually have additional money coming in once we start flattening it out, because I think we're going to have more economic growth. Thank you.
Thank you. Royce?
First, I'm going to clarify one issue. I'm sitting between two council members. And I was present at a council meeting where by 4-1 vote, it was voted to increase taxes in Johns Creek. So let's be clear on that. Brad opposed that tax increase on a dogmatic position that he just opposes all tax increases. I don't believe in that approach to life. On the other side, I have a person who says, well, it really isn't a tax increase because my taxes aren't going up, even though the state said it's a tax increase. Let's be sensible about taxes. Let's not make promises about I'm never going to raise taxes, I'm never going to do this. Christine pointed out, look, we got fees, we got fines, you know, call it whatever you want. There's lots of ways. We know these promises come with caveats. So what's the purpose of tax reform? The purpose of tax reform is to change who the winners and losers are in the game. And that's something that's always a problem. What is my stand on the fair tax? I just want to give you some facts. Georgia collects 50% of its revenues through the income tax.
25% through the sales tax. I'll come back to this question later. I'm sure you got another one.
Thank you. Yes, it'll come up again.
It'll come up again.
Brad, would you like to offer any comments to Royce's comment?
Well, I think it's pretty clear. I don't know if it's being dogmatic or it's a principle that I say I don't support tax increases. So you can take that to the bank. Okay, we need to live within our means. We were handed this paper in City Council, and right there it shows we had a $588,000 tax increase that was voted on this year. I voted against it. Everyone else voted for it. It was a tax increase. And so I'm sorry if people think I'm dogmatic about that, but I think that we can live with our means. The city has a $30 million surplus reserve fund sitting there. In this time of actual plenty, you're telling me that we had to actually increase the people's taxes? It just did not make sense. It did not compute.
Thank you. Kelly?
Thank you. When I came to the City Council, the very first budget that I voted on was for fiscal year 2011. Your real and personal property taxes that year were $15.5 million. The last budget that I voted on for fiscal year 15 for your real and personal property taxes were $15.5 million. As your market assessed value of your house will drop, our millage rate stays the same, your taxes are going to stay around the same. I have never voted for a tax increase and I never will. So let's be clear about the way that that tax proposal was introduced and modified at the City Council meeting on the agenda. If that happened in the State House, that state representative would be laughed out of the building. You don't do things like that. You work together to understand what the impact is going to be. I am not a kind of person who is going to make a political stunt for any kind of gain. That was a purely political stunt, because here's why. If you are against the millage rate, you would be against the budget because of the rate of taxation that is set. Mr. Raffensperger voted against the millage rate, but he voted for the budget, which was set by the very same millage rate he voted again. It was gutter politics.
Thank you. 15 seconds, any comments?
Yes. I guess, Mrs. Stewart, if the millage rate stays the same and taxes go up, is that a tax increase? Because by state law, before we voted on this, I wanted my fellow council members to be clear on this. I think that they weren't very clear on the facts. So I asked Monty Barba, is this a tax law? And he said, by state law, this is a tax increase.
Thank you.
Who am I to argue with the state?
Thank you. Now, I don't even remember where the heck we are now. I'm just totally lost. You got me all off that. Paul, you wanted to make a comment on that? I'm not going to allow it because you were not referenced in the conversation, but I did want to at least bring it up that you had asked for that. It's time to move to the next question, and we will start with Paul. And the question is, what are your thoughts on allowing the use of medical marijuana in Georgia and on allowing it for recreational use, and should growing be allowed in Georgia?
I'm not a doctor. In case you haven't noticed, as a journalist, this is a question for the medical profession. This is not a question really for politicians or people who are not experts. And of course, we should defer to the medical profession. It's that simple. Recreational marijuana is another issue. I have some reservations about it. I know a number of people are looking at this as sort of a quick fix tax scheme. I have grave reservations about that because it's a product that can grow at home. I did some research on that several years ago, and I actually was in public relations. So it's not really quite the panacea for creating revenue that I think people think it is. So I have severe reservations, seriously, about it.
Thank you. We are ready to move to the next round of questions.
No.
Yeah, I told you how long.
Hey,
you come on up here. Did you guys get enough answers on that? You want to handle this for me? Again, let me read the question one more time. What are your thoughts on allowing the use of medical marijuana in Georgia and on allowing it for recreational use? Also, should growing be allowed?
Okay. My answer is yes, yes, and yes. Yes to all three. As a mother, I'm very concerned about the war on drugs and the cost it has for our children. The war that we're fighting on drugs has militarized our police. It has also created more crime. Most of the violent crime in our state is due to drugs. And it's not people using drugs. It's the dealers who are protecting their turf. If we were to legalize the sale of these drugs, we would reduce the violence. We wouldn't have so many broken homes because men are in prison. And now their families are on welfare, and we're supporting a prison industrial complex. The war on drugs is much more dangerous than the drugs. And as a mother, I am afraid of what is happening with all of the violence that is created because of it, but also the police force that are now using no-knock warrants and murdering irreverently. And it's all been brought about because of the war on drugs. This needs to stop, and we shouldn't be afraid of a plant.
Thank you. Brad?
No, I did not support legalizing recreational marijuana. And I do not like or appreciate the term, did I say recreational marijuana? Did I get that right?
That was part of the question, yeah. Medical marijuana and recreational.
I don't know if I, recreational, no.
But it was recreational use, not recreational.
Recreational
marijuana.
Use, no, I don't support that. But medical marijuana, I don't support legalizing that. But if you start talking about cannabis oil, which is a true medical situation, I would thoughtfully consider and like to hear what people have to say. I just have really strong reluctance to even get over that hurdle right now, but I will keep an open mind. I will listen to the experts. I understand there's lots of people clamoring for it, and understand that there are some people where it would make a difference. I just have a strong reluctance to even jump over that hurdle at the present time. Thank you.
Thank you. Royce?
Christine, you might find a fellow libertarian.
Always good to have.
With regards to medical marijuana, I'm with Paul. I think the FDA should look at the issue. I don't think the state should get into the business of what is a good treatment for different diseases. I know people believe it helps in different conditions, but I think that's for the medical profession to figure out, not for the state to legislate. When it comes to recreational marijuana, my view is that 60% of our property taxes in Johns Creek, to Fulton County, is going for our judicial system. And judicial reform and criminal reform is an issue high on the agenda for the governor and for us, because we have to look at the impact of these laws and the cost of these laws and what's happening all across the country. So I think we need to look at our laws and see what makes sense in terms of what we're enforcing and what it's costing us to do that.
Thank you.
I do not support the medical use of I do not support the medical use of marijuana. I do not support recreational use of marijuana, and I do not support growing plants in Georgia for marijuana.
Thank you. Could you be more succinct? Okay, now can we go to the next question? Are we good now? We're good. Sorry. Christine, the next question is, do you support the recreation of Milton County, and why?
Okay. Well, personally, I am in favor of Milton County. As a legislator, though, I'd be more in favor of just getting the state out of the business of telling people what counties and what municipalities they can create. I think those are decisions that need to be made by the citizens. So my stance on that would be that it's up to the people. Yes, I support it personally, but we really need to put it in the hands of you guys. If you want Milton County, then go create Milton County. I don't think anybody should stand in your way.
Yes, I support Milton County. And to Christine's point, unfortunately, we have a state constitution. It's very difficult to do that, so it is a process. But what I said to a lot of people, they just want me to roll over and give up. And I said, well, really, think about Eva Galambos down in Sandy Springs. She fought 25 years to get Sandy Springs, and everyone said she's not going to get it. That woman did get it. She's the Margaret Thatcher of North Fulton because she just had persistency, consistency. And so I believe that with Milton County, we're going to get more local control, more control of our financial future. I believe that taxes will come down, and I think that services will be raised. You just look at what we've done here in the city of Johns Creek. Okay, I was on council too, so you take your shot. But we maybe weren't perfect in all of our services, but it's compared to Fulton County, it's like night and day. You know, we have the best police force in the world. We have the safest city in the state with a population of 50,000. You know, roads are being improved. All these things that have happened with local control, with Milton County, it gets a whole lot better. If nothing else, for a jury service, you don't have to go downtown.
Royce.
I think Milton County is a wonderful idea. But let me talk first about what Fulton County does for you so you'll understand what you're talking about when you say Milton County. 60% of Fulton's budget goes to running the judicial system. So what we're taking on is running the court system. Yeah, you don't have to run downtown to do your jury duty, but it's a lot of money. It's an expensive proposition. 23% of Fulton County goes to running a healthcare system. So do we want to take on running a healthcare system? That includes the North Fulton Health Clinic, Grady Hospital, mental health programs. I mean, think about that. 17% of our budget goes to voter registration, the cooperative extension, I mean, libraries, and we all like libraries. But I think the idea of Milton County is a good one. It's subsumed into the question of how many counties we have in the state. I think we need to right size our counties. We have too many counties, to my mind, to be cost efficient. And I'll get back to Milton County on another question because I'm not done. These 1 minute questions are kind of chop you off because there's some bigger issues with Milton County here.
Thank you. Kelly?
I do support the creation of Milton County. Unfortunately, a lot of legislation has been introduced to try to fix Fulton, and instead of it getting better, it seems like it's getting worse. So it seems like the only alternative we have is to create Milton to try to control our own destiny and stop sending all of our taxes down to the south part of Fulton. It's going to take some work, and it's going to take a lot of effort. I am committed to seeing that done because that is what I consistently hear when I am talking to voters, is my stand on Fulton versus Milton. And I do support us having a Milton County and keeping everything locally in North, in what we now have as North Fulton.
Thank you. Paul?
I'm looking at the issues that are being discussed tonight. We've got education, we've got transportation, we haven't even gotten into job development and economic development. And we're talking about the creation of a county. We've got a heck of a lot more important things to discuss. Isn't that true? We have, by the creation of these cities, and I like the creation of the cities, you've taken the two of the most important powers to yourselves. That is zoning and the police. These are the local powers you want to have. As far as then is going into Fulton County, as has been said here already, you've got a tremendous amount of infrastructure to build if you want to have your own county. We're talking about jails, we're talking about courthouses, all sorts of facilities. This is not going to come cheap. Fulton County is a rather well-run county. It has an excellent bond rating, has a good record nationally. Right now, we've got too many other things on our plate. Let's not get distracted. And that's all this is. Let's not get distracted with another issue.
Thank you. We'll start the next round of questions with Brad, and this is our first audience question. If you had been in office during last year's legislative session, would you have voted yes on House Bill 60, also known as the Guns Everywhere Bill?
I'd have to read that one and know what it is all about. I was asked by NRA what my position was. Now, I believe that we should have the right to buy handguns, and we have the right to carry handguns. I'm not a believer in a gun registration by some policing authority that keeps records of us. I think that people, if they want to carry on a university and they're law-abiding and they have a permit, they should be able to go on campuses, and I think that was a big point of that. So I think visitors, students, I don't have a problem with them if they have a carry permit. That means we've done a criminal background check, so we know that they're safe. I'd have to look at House Bill 60 on the other aspect about the churches. I consider churches private property. And if the pastor's okay with everyone packing, then it's fine with me. If the pastor says no, it's just like when I come over to your house. If I can carry a gun and it's okay with you, then I do. And so I have to respect private property rights.
Thank you. Royce?
I believe in individual freedoms and the minimum government necessary. I will say this, though. If I'm at Target and a guy walks in with a gun, I'll probably walk out of Target. So I'll implement my own rules. I don't know what the law says specifically, but that's kind of my approach. Let's maintain individual freedoms and let's have the minimum guns necessary, but let's not walk around with guns everywhere just to scare kids.
Thank you. Kelly?
I, too, believe in individual freedoms, and I would support House Bill 60.
Paul?
Well, these people were all in college learning things that they could actually use to make a living. I was studying other things that would make me a great Jeopardy contestant, but not really good for making earning your salary. I know the history of the Second Amendment. It is not what a lot of people, it has to actually deal with slavery. It has to do with the southern states insisting that white males have weapons so they can track down runaway slaves and put down slave rebellions. It was held, the Second Amendment was held by James Madison hostage, or actually the Bill of Rights held hostage because he insisted as a slave owner that this be in the Constitution. So let's go back to a little bit of history and why it's really there. More recent history, the reason why we've had a lot of insistence upon freedom of guns is because there's a lot of money involved here. This is a money-driven issue by the manufacturers. So let's put guns in its historical perspective and in its real perspective in terms of the economy and what's driving this issue.
Thank you. Christine?
Well, I can't comment on a bill that I haven't read yet, but I'll tell you my position on guns. I'm completely in support of the Second Amendment as it was written with no restrictions, no registrations. I do think we should be able to carry guns wherever we want to, with the exception of, as was stated, private property rights. If a private business wants to say no guns are allowed, then that's up to them, and you have the option to frequent that business or not. I think guns keep us safe. I think when we advertise that we don't have guns in a particular location, that makes us a target and it makes us vulnerable. I keep a gun in my home. I've actually had occasion to load it and didn't have to use it, thank goodness, but I was prepared to and I was very grateful to have it. I would like to think that my son is just as safe at his school as he is at home, and it concerns me that there is no one even at his school that would be able to protect him if it became necessary. So I am a supporter of guns for protection, and I believe that's what they are. They're not scary. They're only scary when bad men use them. And it's the bad men that we need to be concerned about, not the guns.
Thank you. I've just been advised we're going to take a quick 5-minute break just so we can collect some more questions from the audience. Some of the questions that have been submitted, if I ask you just to keep in mind, if you're going to submit a question, please submit one that can be directed to all of the candidates, not to one in particular. It's just not possible for us to use those questions this evening. So we'll take a 5-minute break. My clock says 7:52. We'll start back at 7:57.
I didn't get very far. That was a short break.
I know.
This is going to be.
I know that's going to be better quality.
So much better than I'll be able to do. They're going to ask what. 25 questions tonight? How do you get it? No, they don't get past the service. Half the questions are in there.
Paul, as soon as you're ready, we are ready to go. Okay, we're going to go ahead and get started again. If anybody has any note cards with questions they want to hand, please give them to Judy.
Which one?
We have 32 more minutes, and I want to go ahead and get started so you can get the benefit of as many answers as possible. This next question, we start with Royce. And the question is, should Georgia revise or expand its current ethics commission? Specifically, do you support the plan for a commission appointed by the governor to be a third, each branch of government, executive, judicial, and legislative, and for members from a particular branch to be required to recuse themselves in cases pertaining to a member of their respective branch?
That's a complicated one. So I'm going to answer it simply. I believe each branch should have an ethics commission, okay, and handle ethics issues. And I think that members should recuse themselves from ethics issues and should not be part of the jury on ethics. that it should be an independent body that addresses ethics questions. I think our history is that we run into problems when members try and address ethics issues between themselves. I think it's a lot better to refer them to an ethics commission and be handled independently and separate from any of the parties involved.
Thank you.
I do support expanding the ethics commission to each of the different branches. And I would also support that when there is a conflict of interest that a member should recuse themselves, because you want to have complete and total transparency and that things are being done honest and ethically and that there's no bias involved.
Paul. Again, let's talk seriously. You have to get to the cause of the problem. And I go back, oddly enough, to a meeting like this several years ago. In fact, Tom Crawford, I was hoping he was going to be here, but he and I, the political writers, we were both there. There was one Republican running for Public Service Commission. And he proposed that any member of the legislature or of one of the commissions excuse himself from voting on any issue where he had taken a contribution from the company in question. I like that guy. I voted for him, by the way. This is nothing true. I like that idea. The other people on the panel, like, were ducking him. They wanted no part of it. It was really interesting. It was like somebody else hand grenade. You've got to start dealing with, when you're talking about ethics, you've got to start really going to where the problem begins, not where the problem ends.
Thank you. Christine?
Well, I would not support an additional layer of government, which is what that sounds like. It's just more government. Appointed by the governor could not be a non-biased panel anyway. But I think ethics is a big concern, but asking the government to police its own ethics doesn't make a lot of sense to me. I think that onus falls on us as individuals. We are the people who keep voting for them. It's our responsibility, and we should take it very seriously. It's our responsibility to know what we're voting for. And that is where I think the ethics needs to happen. It needs to be us doing the research, us holding them accountable. That doesn't happen when we don't have vigorous debate. A lot of our candidates are unopposed. There's not a lot of debate, and this is part of the reason that they get away with ethics issues is because nobody's holding them accountable. They're basically automatically reelected. So I think the real issue is, why don't we have more candidates on the ballot? And that's a ballot access question that you need to be asking as well. Why are Democrats and Republicans keeping third parties off the ballot and keeping it a private club?
Thank you. Brad?
Well, first, I would support a total gift ban, because I think that would cut off some of the problems that we do have with the ethics issues. So a total gift ban would be huge, I think. I also think that what we might need to consider is, would it be perhaps better if instead of the governor appointing folks, it was actually, you had a commission, a statewide ethics commission, and it was retired judiciary or someone like that. Now, in the case of if they're actually investigating judiciary, you might want to make sure that it's maybe retired legislators or something like that. So there is that tension between there. But we want to make sure that whatever they're reviewing, there's no conflicts of interest, and that they're looking at this to make sure that they're getting digging into it with transparency, digging for the truth. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question, we will start with Kelly. Mm-hmm. And the question is, many politicians tout their success in life and or business as reasons to earn votes, but it's often failures and setbacks that make people great leaders. Please provide an example of a significant setback you might have experienced in life that would help you be a better leader.
I am the kind of person that when I take on a challenge, I'm going to see it through to the very end. So I can think of many things where there have been challenges, and you could get frustrated or you could stop, but I think perseverance is a key trait that you need in a representative, somebody that will just keep at it and keep at it. So there are, I mean, different things that I could think of that if it was as a county administrator, a house bill that I was trying to work on that I received roadblocks, or if it was in the city council where I was trying to work on a massage parlor ordinance, or an ethics ordinance to preserve free speech, or to stop the investigation with the mayor, or to not protect the city manager. There are many things that I have had setbacks and I have lost on votes, but I have continued to work, and I have never given up on that until I achieved the goal.
Thank you. Paul?
This is a good question. I like the question. And boy, I always go back. I dwell more on my defeats than my victories, because they bother me more. I keep going back in my career as a journalist in particular, but I didn't ask one more question. I didn't get one more fact. And stories that still bother me to this day, that I didn't go as far as I should have. Maybe I didn't have time, but I should have done it. And that's the thing that bothers me most, and probably the thing that has propelled me on, is the realization I cannot allow myself to do it. When you deal with, and you look at state legislatures, and I have, the most respected people in a legislature are the people who know the facts. There are very few of them, by the way, in any legislature, true story. But the guys on either party who know the details, who know the issues, are the go-to guys. Those are the people who get things done. They have the most respect and the most power. That's the person I have to be. I have to go down to the legislature and realize I am there to work. I am there to be the person who knows the issues.
Thank you.
Well, I've had setbacks. For 10 years, I've been working with the Libertarian Party. For 10 years, we've been trying to get candidates on the ballot. I have knocked on thousands of doors. Can't tell you how many candidates I've petitioned for trying to get our candidates on the ballot. We've had setback after setback after setback, but I'm still here. I got an opportunity to be on the ballot without petitioning, and that was my chance to give a choice to you guys. But I've never stopped, and I'm not going to stop, because I believe that Georgia needs an option. And just because we're not Republican or Democrat, a lot of people have said, why don't you just run as a Republican? Well, that's not who I am. Why don't you run as a Democrat? You could get on the ballot. That's not who I am. I am determined that one day I will be able to get on the ballot as who I am. And I'll keep knocking on doors, and we'll keep signing petitions, and we'll keep trying until we get there. So is that perseverance? Is that leadership? That's for you to judge. But I think that it's important for the state of Georgia that we keep trying, because we do need that third voice.
Thank you. Brett.
Can you read the question again?
Yes. Many politicians tout their success in life and or business as reasons to earn votes, but it's often failures and setbacks that make people great leaders. Please provide an example of a significant setback you may have experienced that would help you be a better leader.
Wow. I don't know where to start, because I've had plenty of setbacks. I guess if you want to know something, I'm real and authentic, you know. I guess I am very fortunate that even though I have had setbacks family-wise and you know, business-wise, that I met a strawberry blonde in grade 11, and Trish and I, we married when I was halfway through college. And so I have had setbacks in my life in business. On 9/11, just before that happened, I decided I was going to buy a real estate up in New York City for a new business we were doing up there. Then 9/11 happened. That business didn't go too well. And so that was a financial setback. But as I faced setbacks in my life, I learned that I could lean into two things. I could lean into my faith, and I could lean into my wife. And I have a tremendous love for my wife, and she has for me. And that's really what gets me through setbacks that I do face from time to time. Thanks.
Thank you. Royce?
I'm a naturally optimistic and happy person, so if I've had setbacks, I've forgotten about them. But I've seen setbacks in other people. Okay. I want to thank the mayor, Corey, and Brad, actually, for voting for the CDBG grant for Johns Creek. Because that grant helps people in our community who have setbacks. And I believe that we should govern with heart. And that's my philosophy of government.
Next question, and this is an audience question. Are you willing to use the 10th Amendment, and we're starting with Paul, are you willing to use the 10th Amendment to fight federal legislation that is unconstitutional and the 10th Amendment provides each state, that says each state retains its sovereignty, freedom, and independence.
Well, the decider of whether or not something is unconstitutional is not the state, it's the Supreme Court. So I don't really quite understand the question. As to division, the 10th Amendment says powers which are not given to the federal government are then given to the state. And that's clearly an important amendment, and clearly one that has to be protected. Recognizing the reality that we have now a national economy. Things are totally different from Washington and Adams' days. We live in a very unified national economy. So it's very difficult to have specific state situations. You certainly can't do that with air pollution because air blows across. We have the situation with Tennessee over water rights. So there's all sorts of situations that really limit what really states do, real world. So to suggest that we can stop the federal government from doing things is not really at all a practical idea.
Thank you. Christine?
Well, states' rights are not just about what's practical and what has come to pass. I mean, I think our founding fathers intended for us, they expected us to refuse to follow laws that were not constitutional. The states have the right to nullify, and I think absolutely Georgia should exercise that right. We should be nullifying laws that are not constitutional. We should be taking back our states' rights. We should never have forfeited them in the first place. So yes, I would support using the 10th Amendment.
Thank you.
Could you repeat the question?
Yes, are you willing to use the 10th Amendment to fight federal legislation as unconstitutional?
Yes. If it's unconstitutional, we should be fighting it. It only makes sense to me. We have state rights, and when you have overreach from the federal government, I think it's time for the states to band together, or if there's only one state that wants to stick his head up and you know, stand and be counted, yes, you should fight. Thank you.
Thank you.
I support all the amendments, including the 10th Amendment. Let's be simple about that. But let's understand one issue while we think about the state and the federal government. This is a relationship that we get into voluntarily. The state spends $40 billion and only raises $20 billion. Okay? Guess where the other $20 billion come from? So there's a little bit of a game here in that, you know, we sort of get into this bed willingly because we get that money from the federal government. And from other states, we're not so happy to give it to Georgia, but hey, we'll take it. Okay. And it helps us improve our community. So we have to be careful about this, let's go off and create a new confederacy. We're part of a country. I mean, we need to sort of stick together and forget, and not forget that the Civil War is over.
Thank you. Kelly?
Yes, most definitely I would.
Thank you. We will start the next round of questions with Christine. Please provide your thoughts on charter schools and Common Core in Georgia.
Okay.
In 1 minute or less. Sorry.
I'll try to do that. Well, we talked about this earlier. I am in favor of charter schools, but I'm more in favor of private schools so that students and parents have more choice. I think Common Core is fine, but it's not great for everybody. 2 million students do not all work the same. They don't all need to be held to the exact same standards. Parents need to be more involved in choosing what type of education their children are going to get. It's way too important to hand it over to one team at the federal level to tell us how all of our children are going to be educated. There are a lot of different methods and a lot of different options, and we are not being presented with all those options, so I would encourage as much as possible privatization so that parents can make choices for themselves to choose a Common Core school or a non-Common Core school as they see fit for their own child.
Thank you. Brett?
I think raising test scores is admirable, but I don't think that Common Core is the way to go. Because what I see with Common Core, it seems like it's been pushed by with a leftist philosophy, and underneath all of that is it says, I am not proud to be an American. And I think we need to replace that maybe with the American Core, where we teach American history like they did when I was a little kid. We learned about our county, then we learned about our state, and then we learned about our nation. I thought this was the best country in the world, and guess what, I still do. And I think the people that grew up with that education from the 60s, and definitely the 50s, the older generation, I guess I am, you know, we had a deep respect and love for our country, and I think that's very important. I have three boys, and they all learned it different ways. I believe in online learning. My son that works with me, he had a little trouble, speech impediment, things like that. So the classroom sitting wasn't the best thing for him. Yet with online learning, that's how he got his degree. I guess my other son, War Eagle, he went the traditional route. He's here tonight. My other son's, I guess, traditional now, and he's at Southern Poly. I think that charter schools, vouchers, different ways of helping kids reach their full potential benefits all of us.
Thank you. Roy?
It's a two-part question, right? First was, what do I believe on charter schools, and what do I believe? Second part is Common Core.
Yes.
Charter schools. Well, I think we all know that all Fulton County schools are now charter schools.
Okay.
So what does charter schools mean? Charter schools means that we give local control to the school as to what's being taught. And I think that's a good idea. They are still supervised by the school board in terms of making sure we have a program. Let me then go to Common Core, and let me give you a little history on what Common Core is. Governor Perdue, a Republican, came up with Common Core, and he's trying to address a basic problem that Georgia and a lot of southern states are perceived not to have the standards of education of other states in this country. And I think that we need to, the attempt of Common Core was to put out the message that Georgia is the same as every other state, that we have the same standards, come do business in Georgia. We are not a worse state than Massachusetts or Minnesota or some other place. So the objective of Common Core at a sales level is to sell the state of Georgia as having the same educational standards, and there's no better state in the union. So we can improve the standards, we need standards, the state spends money on schools, and we need standards for our schools.
Thank you. Kelly?
I support the expansion of charter schools, and as it relates to Common Core, I could not be more against it. I am against anything where Washington, D.C. would try to tell a parent, a teacher, or a school administrator that they know best about a child. That is the parent's responsibility, together locally with the teacher and that local administrator. I'm for tough standards, but I am not for Common Core.
Thank you.
I try to analyze not only how things are, but how they will evolve. And I do have problems with charter schools because, again, many of these are for-profit. And I have difficulty dealing with children as a profit center. I have difficulties of dealing with companies who will seek to raise additional revenue by parent fees in order to make profit targets. So I have serious reservations about the charter schools and the private schools. Common Core, we're a very mobile society. And most of the people in this room have lived in other states. I've lived in four. And one of the things is when you move from one state to another and you move your child into the fifth grade, that fifth grade has to be the same level of education as your previous state. You cannot simply have every state defining what the sixth, seventh, and eighth grade is. You have to have a national standard for us to be able to survive as a national economy.
Thank you. We're going to have one more round of 1 minute answer questions, then we're going to have closing statements. We'll probably be 4 or 5 minutes after 8:30 when we finish. But I did want to mention there are some questions in case you want to ask after the forum, the candidates specifically. There was a question on whether or not we should tax alternative fuel vehicles, which we're going to leave out. Question on economic development policies to encourage growth in the state of Georgia, expanding access to health care, not health care insurance, but health care itself, and then also any legislation to regulate the for-hire or Uber, the for-hire industry or Uber. But we're going to finish with this question, and then we'll have closing statements, and we will start with Brad. The question is, whoever is elected will be the newest member of the Georgia General Assembly. How will you work to develop relationships with and earn the trust of the other 235 members to accomplish your legislative priorities?
I have good relationships with several House members already. I'm actually in the class of 2015 Republican Leadership of Georgia. It's the old Coverdale Institute, so I'm going through that this year. There's actually a sitting House rep that's in there, and so I've reached out to him and I've gotten some good advice. One of the things that he said is that I will get the worst office down there in the state capitol. So that's fine. It happened to me when I was on a construction site years ago too. So I am a hard worker and I'm a teachable student. And I think that's the most important thing. I reached out to someone that's recognized as the top expert on health reform, who believes in private, voluntary, free market reform. And so I'm reaching out to people as I run this race to become an educated future representative. I look forward to serving the people. I will work hard, and you don't have to worry about me missing meetings. I'll be there every day, and I'll make sure that I put in the time to service our constituents.
Thank you. Royce?
I'll build relations with other members of this legislature. Let's remember there's 180 members in the legislative assembly, so I'll be one of 180 if elected. But I'll build relationships by showing that I work based on facts, reasoning, and understanding. That it's not my opinion that I'm trying to sell, that I'm representing the people of Johns Creek, and that what I'm speaking for is for you.
Thank you. Kelly?
Relationships matter. You can't alienate people on one thing and expect to work with them on another. You can disagree without being disagreeable. I think politics doesn't have a place in the state house. It doesn't have a place in the city council. It doesn't have a place in the Senate or in government anywhere. I have very good relationships with the governor. I have relationships with many state house reps and with many state senators. I would use those relationships to work with the North Fulton delegation to continue working on the issues that are important to us. I would go down there, committed to doing what I'm doing, work as hard as I have worked on the city council, and just the tenacity and the resolve to go down there and do what you have sent me to do. I would also work with you. If I am elected and you have not even voted for me, that's okay. I would represent you too, and your interests would be important for me. So when you represent, you have to represent everybody in your district and work with everybody down at the Capitol.
Thank you. Paul?
As you know, I'm running as an independent this time, and I will not join either party or either caucus. There'll be times I vote with the Republicans, I can imagine that, and there'll be times I'll vote with the Democrats, I can imagine that. But I will not be under the control of any party bosses or any party leadership. I will be able to represent you and your interests, and I will be able to stand up and speak strongly for them, because I do not have to follow the party leadership. But as I also alluded to earlier, the effectiveness of any legislator is how hard they work at learning the issues, knowing the facts, not only knowing them, but also doing the analysis. I think we just saw this evening on the fair tax. Doing the analysis and finding out where it actually runs. The charter schools, doing the analysis and seeing where they're actually going to, how the dominoes are going to fall. These are important qualities to an effective legislator. I am prepared to go down there and do a lot of hard work.
Thank you. Christine?
Well, I don't see any reason why I would have a problem working with other legislators. I think that I could appeal to them with my logic. I'm very straightforward. I have a clear set of principles. There would be no question about which way I would fall on an issue. But in my past history, I've always found that it's been easy for me to help bring two different opinions together. Because I like to think that most of us are good and we're trying to do the right thing. We just have different approaches, but we usually want the same thing. And that attitude has worked well for me in many settings, where I'm able to take people who seem like they're coming from completely opposite viewpoints and find that kernel within them that is the same and build on that. And so I think I could do that with the legislature, and I think there's no reason that I would have a problem working with anybody.
Thank you. We're going to handle our closing statements now, and we will actually go in the opposite order as from opening statements. So, Paul, we will start with you.
First of all, again, thank you for your attention tonight and being so patient with all of us. I want to go back to where I started from. This is a very important election. Make no doubts about it. Because now we're past all the national issues and state issues and all the TV ads that we had in the general election. Now we can focus on real issues. The real issue right now, the most immediate one, impacting this district is education on two levels. We've got to get at least the funding back in that we need to have a full curriculum. And we've got to do that now. The other thing is, and I want to point out to you, even those of you who don't have children in the schools, this is still an important issue to you. Because where do people want to move? Where the good schools are. Good schools mean higher property values. This is important to everyone in this room, to protect your own, your most important investment. So again, it's up to you. It's not just me, it's up to you. If you want to make this state, if you want to tell the state legislature and the governor, we want that money back now. We're not waiting for our children to wait for them later. We want them to have a full curriculum, full activities now. Here is your chance to have your voice heard.
Thank you. Kelly?
Thank you so much to the JCCA tonight for hosting this event, and thank you for being here. It's been a pleasure spending a few minutes with you talking about the issues that are important in this race. I have an established record as a reliable, principal leader. I have stood alone. I have fought against petty politics that have embarrassed our city, that have wasted our tax dollars. I have stood alone on important issues that we have faced as a city. I do believe in doing the right thing every time and doing it well. I do believe in perseverance. I do believe in hard work. I believe character and integrity and a work ethic is important to the person that you send to the State House. And I am asking for your vote and will work to earn your support for the election on January 6th. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Royce?
Let me thank everybody once again for listening to everything. I wish there had been more questions and I could have answered more questions. I want to encourage you to, if you have the time, to go visit my website, Google me, it will come up, and learn more about the issues. I also have some materials on the back that talk about the state budget and the facts that are all involved. It's important for you to consider all the candidates. Pick the best one, the one that meets your needs, and hopefully you pick me, but consider everybody. What I want to do is here, wrap up though, is mention that there's 180 members of the House, of the State House. And being elected to the State House, you'd be a junior member of the House. And a lot of people can stand up here and promise that we're going to do all sorts of things. Believe me, some of those promises are overblown. But what we can promise, and what I promise to you, is to actually reach out and listen to you. Because the point is to represent you, not to be there to represent my opinions, I certainly have them, but to represent your opinions and be your representative in the State House. Thank you.
Thank you. Brad.
Thank you for coming tonight. I truly believe that the very best of the Republican ideals is when we have our heart, you know, balanced with wisdom, which we get from our brain, and then we have grace balanced with accountability. And I think when we have a conviction and the courage to lead forward with those ideals, that we can accomplish great things. And it's that, really, that balance that I have, you know, compels me and drives me forward to say that we need to eliminate the state income tax and we need to replace it with the fair tax. And that's why today I really believe that we need to repeal the 17% Fulton County tax. And we need Milton County. We need tax reform for the state. It'll benefit our taxpayers. And that's where my heart really is for the taxpayers of the state of Georgia. I think that we have a tremendous state. We have some great leadership down at the State House. I would be humbled, and I would work very hard if you elected me to this office. I will give you my very best. Thank you very much. I'm asking for your vote on Tuesday, January 6th. Merry Christmas.
Christine?
Well, I also want to thank everybody for coming. I know this was short notice, and I'm really impressed by the number of people that are in this room that actually care about what we have to say. So thank you for listening. I feel like there's only one person here who has consistently told you that I am going to restore freedoms on every question that we've been asked. One of the things that didn't come up is small business rights and property rights. I am an avid defender of small business. I want to reduce all the regulations that are acting as a roadblock to small business. I want to defend your property rights. I want to protect you as individuals are going to go to the Capitol to watch out for you, protect your rights, reduce the size of government, and put the power back into your hands, because I believe that you are the best people to make decisions for yourself. And that's why you've heard me say today on almost every question that I'm for letting you make the decision. Do you want to carry guns? Do you want to smoke marijuana? Where do you want your kids to go to school? Do you want to reduce your taxes? In every case, I think I've been consistent that you should have the power, you should have the rights, it should be your decision. And that's what I would fight for. It's very simple, very concise, and I hope you'll consider it. I also want to tell you, I have a few videos that have recently been published, if you want to go to my Facebook page, so you can get more details about some of the issues we talked about today. And hopefully you can see that a mom in the House representing Johns Creek would be a great thing.
Thank you. I'd like to apologize to anybody who submitted questions that we were not able to get to. We just simply ran out of time. I believe all the candidates intend to hang around shortly for a while after the forum in case you have any questions that were not answered specifically. And I think they all deserve a nice round of applause. Thank you. Thank you.
Where do you want us to stay?
Right.